Now, the last time we worked on this, we were in the middle of installing the servos, getting the electronics for the Z-tron installed in this, and then doing some preliminary tests, hooking up the linkages. And today we're going to try to get the bulk of that job done. And we're going to answer the phone. Now, the last time I worked on this, I had servos and batteries and chargers and schematics, and what I'm going to do is finish my coffee here. I always try to spend, and it's worked out well for me, I've always tried to spend the first 10 minutes of the day, 5 minutes, kind of looking around at, so I get a focus on what I really want to accomplish today. A lot of people just run down the shop and start doing something without having a plan. Well, my plan, as always, is to try to do things or try to accomplish things that either not many other people have done or in some cases nobody's ever done. I'm not sure. But that's the part of the hobby I've come to enjoy the most. And it's Z-tron. Installing a Z-tron. This is the first time I've ever installed a twin engine one. I don't know how this is going to work out, but I'm going to allocate the best part of the next 2 or 3 days to really trying to get a system that works reliably. And if I have any problems with it at all, of course, Sergio is only a half hour away or only a phone call away. So I really want to get his help. I want to make this as reliable, as bulletproof as possible, because this is going to be the prototype for all the production units that will get sold from this point in time on. So, of course, the first thing of the day is, like every day we ever work here, the first thing is clear the table and try to get a way of jigging this upside down in position so we can start laying out the electronics. And that's always a time-consuming job because this plane hangs off the tail, the end, the bent. It's just not, you just don't grab it and flip it over here. And by the way, I've come to appreciate another thing. A tricycle gear plane, this thing is a rollerball. Everybody that's ever bumped into a wingtip here, this thing starts rolling off the table. So I've made up these little, well, I already had them made, but I put even a little bit bigger chocks on so there would be no chance it would roll off the table. That's a scary possibility. You'd probably break right in half or something. And believe it or not, I know years ago, John DeTavio, a true story, John DeTavio had a beautiful plane. I mean, buffed out. It was just one of the most gorgeous planes, one of his Falcons that I've ever seen. And here we're all downstairs in the cellar, and I hear, well, what happened? It rolled off the kitchen table and broke in half. So it can happen. These chalk things are good insurance. And since I now have this plane to store, now that it's in one piece for the first time, it It doesn't fit on that little work table anymore. It takes up, it needs its own hanger or whatever. And I'm not sure yet. It's pouring rain out there today. I'm not sure that we're going to be able to even get this in the car without some kind of monumental nightmare, but we're going to find that out too. And when I know it's going to rain the whole day, basically it's going to rain for the next 2 or 3 days, this will give me a nice time window to work on and getting that Zetron installed and tested. And that's one of the final things before we'll be ready to bench run the motors and, well, synchronize them, get the linkages synchronized. Now, the whole idea of this from the get-go was that I could take this nose hatch off in one piece. I wanted to locate the switch so I could reach in up here. And this, I don't want to try to accomplish this in, you know, in an hour or something. Because I want, this is something, a part of the plane that's going to be like a maintenance item. I'm going to be going over and over. Now, where is that? Glad I don't even know where the switch is. Anyway, I wanted to figure out if I can put the switch right behind the nose wheel here. The wires that are going to come from the servo, I have to make a harness. And then I can kind of balance the plane with having heavier or lighter batteries, although maybe we're going to need a car battery up in the front here. I don't know. Never underestimate when the nacelles get short on a plane what a dramatic effect that has on the balance. Start with these wires, which branch out into the two servos. The first thing I want to do is figure out how I want to mount the switch here. I need to know right behind. Oh, I maybe can make a little plate that'll attach to this. I have to look at how this is going to work. And maybe I can come up with, since I'm not worried about weight up here, some way of maybe even reinforcing this a little bit. A little piece of plywood. That's going to be challenging. I want to figure out how, that's the first step, how I want to mount the switch. The ideal location for this would be that you could just slide your finger in here and have the center of the switch right over this piece of wood here. So I don't want it any further. I don't want to have to go back like that, like I'm choking the plane. Right here would be the ideal spot. So now that I know that, I can make up a piece of 1/8-inch light ply or 1/16 plywood or whatever. And I know I'd like the switch itself to be centered right over this. So it can act as a even though we don't need a reinforcement, that's pretty solid. I can come up with some kind of a piece of plywood. I'll make a pattern. Again, you could have the switch out the side, but if it's in here, the advantage is you don't have to look at it. And every little thing I can do to make this cosmetically more scale, you know, the better it is. Trace a pattern just by going off the fuse sides. And I know I'm going to have to go in just roughly thickness of the fuse side, which is 1/8 of an inch. Just lets me rough out a pattern out of 1/8-inch light ply. Now, just made this oversized. Now I can estimate where that's going to go. I wound up making this piece and using it as a pattern to cut a piece from my carbon fiber test material. This is about 1/3 the weight of the plywood, so we certainly don't need a motor mount to just be able to get in and get the switch working. And it worked out to be that our switch, I made it so that the position for flying is on. When we're done flying, it's off, on. Kind of simple. Now the next thing I have to do is lay out the piece and where exactly the Zetron is going to, the little receiver is going to come out the side here. So the objective is to get it in a spot where it'll be easy to work on if I have to. And since I have doublers up here in the nose, this might be a good spot right up here. I need to just make a perfectly smooth hole just the size of the receiver. The little infrared eye that comes in there. Now all that we need for the mount is that this little the receiving eye, the infrared eye, needs to face in. I'd like to have this, the way that's worked well for me in the past is just to mount this into a block of foam rubber with double-sided tape, that 3M tape that they mount, what the hell they use it for, they mount pictures with it or whatever. I have some over in the Zetron box. So I can make up a little piece of balsa wood even or something that's going to hold this, where this piece actually is mounted in foam. Now, I don't want any glue or anything that I can't take this right off. I want to be able to, one of my requirements for this ship was, or for anyone, would be that you can replace the switch, replace the unit, replace the battery, replace the servos, all with plug-in. You can do it right at the field, right on a moment's notice. So, and of course, having a spare of every part is almost a mandatory part of a project this complex. So I want to figure out how exactly I want to have this attached to the plane. Actually, I could hold it in this piece. I can make a little, another way I can do this, I can make a little piece of balsa wood that just holds this in place. See, the idea of the foam is it isolates it from vibration too. So I've got a lot of choices here. I just want to look at a lot of different ways of doing this and then figure out how I want to do this. And once I'm satisfied, then I can... See, I don't want this where the nacelle is going to block it off either. I want it to be as far forward as possible, but I don't want to cut a hole in a window. So right behind here on the inside of the fuselage would look like that's the most simple place to mount it. Trying to come up with a... Of course, I want it to be that I can take it out. I try to make this little box-like guy up. Similar, it's exactly similar to what we used in a profile, except it'll be inside the fuselage with a little spacer block. And then what I can do, of course, I haven't really put this all together yet. I want this to be mounted in foam. I'll cut the foam away so that the foam will just squeeze that in there, kind of sandwich it in there. And I can trim the foam to the exact size I need. This part can get mounted with a blind nut to the inside of the plane. Then I can disconnect this, work on wiring, whatever, and then just put it back in with one 440 screw. So I don't know if this is going to evolve in the next hour or so into something a little bit more sophisticated, but the idea is I don't want to have this rigid mounted. I want it to have just a little bit of foam on both sides. I'll cut a little sliver of foam so that that's mounted right in foam. Also, to have the receiver eye as close to the edge of the fuselage. I don't want it inside the fuselage by a quarter of an inch. So that should give me the best of all worlds, I hope. And sometimes coming up with a little box like this or something like this, it just makes you crazy, but then in the end you say, oh, that was easy. Now I wanted to find out, now that we have the mount made, let's see how far forward that can go. This is all clear up here. What I did, I took a piece of tubing, sharpened it on a grindstone. I want to find the spot that I'll be happiest with here. It's got to be a little further down. And that'll be the little access hole for the receiver eye. Now we have to line up the receiver eye with that hole. So many hours of making these little boxes, it's making me crazy. The thing is, this part has to sit through so that you can see it in the fuselage side. Now, the trick to getting this lined up is, once you cut the hole, that eye wants to be, the receiving eye wants to be right in the center. And we want to get this just tack glued in place using the little box itself for the alignment. Let me just show this. We have that in pretty good confinement. Now what I'm going to do is just put one drop of thick CA on this side. Until I get this lined up exactly the way I want it. That should be lined up relatively well now. Now we can take the box apart, of course, but the problem is we're at the end of this workday, so we're going to continue the wiring tomorrow. That's about enough for one day, and even a little thing like that box, it just consumes time. And we'll come back and work on this tomorrow. Now today, up to this point, we have only ever run a Zetron running one servo, and of course a one servo, one engine. And that technology is pretty much in the bank, running one servo off a Zetron. I would say it's totally reliable, at least for what we're doing it is. And we've had several people other than people in our own little group able to do that successfully. Now the challenge is to up the ante to where we're going to try to run two servos at the same time. And I realize after a long call with Sergio last night, I spoke to him about several other little things that we were working on, but the biggest thing he got me mad when he said, you put the wires in a wing already, why you idiot? You could have had them with the connectors already put on from FMA. And I look in FMA's catalog, and sure enough, they make exactly what I needed. It's got a connector on one end that would plug into the Zetron and two servo. Well, now I got to undo everything. I got to do it with Dean connectors because I put the wires in and didn't realize that was the best way to go. So like all mistakes, when you make a mistake, you got to pay. Now what's funny is, hey, I always have this bubble pack under the tail because I'm not used to having the motors in the plane. Well, with the motors in, it at least balances on the wheels. Sometime during the day today, when George is done with his art lessons, he's going to try to stop by and do a photo shoot for me. He's already working on the official B-25 oil painting, which, by the way, copies will be available for a nominal charge. We're also thinking about putting that oil painting on some t-shirts. If anybody's interested in some t-shirts, you know, we can make a good deal for you. Anyway, if we get to do the photo shoot, great, but I have a couple hours this morning I'm going to work on. And the thing I want to work on is I want to hook the wire from the Zetron. I have three wires going each wing, and had I known this, of course, had I thought this through a little better, I could have had the connectors already in place and just plug it. Right now, I'd be done, in other words. So instead, I have a couple hours of work soldering Dean connectors on everything and lining everything up. It's something you want to keep in mind if you're doing it. Well, like a Wolf Brownell, a twin-engine plane. Anything with two engines, they make that Y connector. And you can get it right from FMA. The learning curve on everything, and this is one of the things I hope you can pick up from the video anyway. Everything you do in life is a slow learning curve. What I need to do now is take the servo out of here. I need to, in essence, make up my own Y connector. Now, Sergio has never done one with two engines, with two servos, so the plan is to try to come up with a couple of things. First off, if we need X amount of ounces of nose weight, is to make or somehow incorporate a much larger battery into the plane, which that would be a nice feature if we could do it. Just make taking it apart and charging it less often, that would be one of the advantages. Now this has a connector on this side, so what I need to do is make a harness up now with this connector, and I need to get the signal wire, the plus and the minus, the same to both servos. So I'm going to have to take the cowls off, pull all my wires through and start matching them up, make a little diagram of which one the signal is, which one the positive and which one negative, and then make sure both servos are turning in the same direction. Oh, that I don't hook something up backwards and screw up one of the servos. This is my spare for testing, so I already have the other two mounted in the plane. Now, luckily, because we made these cowls easily removable, taking it on and off is not a big job. And you can imagine how many things you could have that would make this a nightmare. For instance, that you have to take the needle valves out every time you want to take the cowls off. Or you have to take the mufflers off or something like that. We haven't done the mufflers yet, but trying to engineer this up so it's easy to work on, relatively, no, easy is not the right word, but doable would be a better word. Anyway, I think we're going to achieve that, but getting this harness made up, again, you can picture in your mind that this has to just be a Y connector. You can eliminate this whole step just by one call to FMA and get the thing, and it's burning me up now that I didn't do that because it'd already be done. This would be what would be involved, chunk, and I'd be ready to go to the field or ready to test. The mistake I made is not leaving these wires long enough. In fact, you can see only half of them are going to reach all the way. The other half don't. Well, what I'm going to try to do then is run one set of wires and put the connector in the middle. But the problem with that is that creates extra joints, extra solder joints, extra, well, things that I really don't want to have. You'd like to have no joints at all or as few as possible. Well, we've kind of dropped the football on this one, but I think we're going to be able to recover, and we're going to be able to come up with a harness, our own harness, and we already have the wires going out to the servos. We're just going to need to make the connectors the same on the servo ends, and if we don't have those connectors in our box of junk, then what I'll have to do is put Dean's connectors on both sides. Keep a box with even parts that are broken, servo ends. See, right here I have one of the ends. Fred Cronwett sent me some ends with wires. I don't throw anything away. One thing about it, you get a little Zetron box like this, I found it real handy. Keep all the little things together and always make a little, I got it going here already, a little wiring diagram of what's going on in each one of the planes you set up. Seems intimidating, it seems like a lot of work, but when you're done, and by the way, you can buy the nice FMA, this is one Sergio game, with three color-coded wires. One of the things I didn't realize is how many choices of, let's see what size this is. And you can put your own ends on. Once you get comfortable with this soldering thing, and I'm not comfortable yet at all, but I'm learning, each one I do gets a little bit better, a little bit quicker. So what I decided to do rather than use Dean connectors is just make wire joints with a little shrink tube over them here. Because either way, if I have to replace a servo, I'm going to have to do some real work. And having a Dean connector, the new servos won't have a Dean connector. So I said there was no advantage other than just, may as well just do it the hard way and just solder them up and put the little heat shrink tubings on them when they're done. And it might save a little bit of weight, but I couldn't find enough connectors. I couldn't justify having all that connector material in here. Once we get the muffler in here and everything, this is going to get real crowded and real busy. And I don't think these wire joints will be a problem at all. Look at that octopus here. I got all the little joints made, and the only downside here is if I have to replace a servo, I'll have to do the soldering, but I'd never go out to the field with the plane without having some way of doing that. Even if I couldn't solder, I could twist wires together temporarily. That's all. Yeah, I wish I had it a different way, but you know, it's just not going to happen. I just don't have the right stuff here. Anyway, the right stuff. How appropriate. Now I want to saddle these pigtails, and then I have the original piece that came off the servo I can attach on here, but I need it. Of course, I didn't think this through when I made the wire harnesses. If I made them 3 inches longer, I wouldn't need a splice. So exactly what I don't want to do is what I'm going to have to do is put a splice in these. But I'm getting familiar enough with it, writing down all my notes. And I think eventually I'm going to have, I'll be able to service this at the field very quickly and very easily. Everything comes apart here. The cowls come right off. That'll be part of it. And my multiple wire harness with multiple joints, And I've tried my best to try to get these joints, the heat shrink tubing around them, and then one larger piece of heat shrink tubing to kind of contain that. Put some twists in the wires just to keep them from flopping around. We're actually ready to install this and start working on a battery mount. Like a test battery. Now keep in mind what we're going to do is eventually, if we need
X amount of nose weight. Again, we're going to work on having the nose weight to be the battery. And I've got a blind nut and a mount, everything up there. But for right now, I can just lay that in there, since we're not going to, right now, we don't know where that's going to wind up. And what I need to do is, there's a simple test for a Z-tron installation. All you need to do, get off my shoulder. All you need to do is put the switch on, and if the servos move, you're in. And they both move. They're both moving in the same direction. I was hoping this would go the way Sergio thought it would, since this is the first one we've ever done. Okay, so we're going to leave the Z-trons off. And now what I need to do, the next step in the test would be, take the little receiver, turn the Z-tron on. It can make you crazy, and it makes me crazy too. These little receiving units are three channels. And it's so easy, since there's nine pins, you could put it in, it's like a set of dominoes, and I just had this in the wrong way. So, heaven forbid I should look at the directions again. The white wire goes in the front. Signal. Okay, there we go. Whenever you get, here's the symptom, whenever you get to where it's not operating reliably, but you're getting little blips, what it means is you're on the wrong channel, go check the directions. Shush, you're on the wrong channel. Where's our little receiver? Now they are both operating in true synchronous harmony. So now I feel, before I go to the next step, I'll shut this off and save the battery. I made my little box up to mount this up in the nose. That'll be the next step on this little operation. And see if we have a reliable. Again, a nice thing about this setup is, where's my sponge? Ah, the bird ate the sponge. The nice thing about this installation is everything is serviceable. The only bad side is we have the servo situation that we have is not the best. But I don't have those little connectors. But what I could do is at some future time, down a hobby shop and get the right connectors for those. But the Deans are okay. I don't even need the Deans, to tell you the truth. So now we have this little unit that gets plugged in, and then we can do all our testing right through the little opening in the fuselage side. Line this up, I have to make sure that the receiving eye on the infrared is looking right out the window. Okay, now the test would be, now what I do is every time I do something, I go back and just do a quick test that I haven't pinched a wire or put, because I'm not real hip to this. Quiet. Okay, so we haven't lost any of our continuity here. Okay, that's done, all the wires are in, we have a test battery in place. For right now, I could just put a piece of foam in here to hold the battery until we make the final mount. This I'd like to figure some way maybe of zip tying that down a little bit better, although it's not going to go anywhere. So many steps to this. Oh, I have to make the linkages up for it. I got to go get the servo arms and the linkages for the carburetors. See how we have these made up. I just put this little piece on. Of course, this is not critical. You can use ball link. Get out of here. Use some kind of ball link or something on that. There's a thousand little things you can do at the hobby shop. But what I want to do is set the throttles so that full wide open, and then drop my servo arm on and make sure I can get, I have to cut one end off or otherwise it'll come out, so that I have the full range of travel. And I've already bench tuned these. I got them close anyway, that they don't shut off when they're idling or anything like that. And of course we're going to test run it on the ground anyway, but making up the linkage from the servo arm to this, and then this little adjustment here will give me a fine tuning on it. If you need more than a fine tuning, you take the servo arm off and just move it one notch, like on the face of a clock.
So you really have infinite amounts of adjustment. And then I need to fine adjust them that they both shut at the same time and they both open at the same time. And then when that's all done, I can get these wires out of the way. I want to just maybe put a zip tie or something on so they're behind the motor. I don't need these hanging out in the open anymore. All these optional servo arms here. What we want is the one that has two arms. And what we're going to do is just, with a Dremel tool, just cut one arm off. We only need one of them. Second thing is that the little nylon pin is a little bit oversized, so I want to put a precision hole. I might put a mic on that. Get a precision hole in the arm. So I don't. The worst thing to have is slopping a linkage, because every time the motor's running, the thing is just beating itself to death. So I want to get a nice tight precision fit here. Now I've run into a problem that I didn't anticipate. The linkage here, because you don't get a 90 degree servo travel. So what I'm doing here, the way I can cure this will be very easy. I can just move this up into the hole closer to the linkage, pull that linkage off and re-drill it. Of course, I'm in the outermost hole here. And what that'll do, it'll give me quicker throttle response too. Now notice this is funny, I'm pointing this away from the plane. Point it to the ground, point it to the sky. What happens with infrared, it reflects off everything. So the first adjustment I have to make is I'm going to move this up one hole, and that'll give me, see, I don't know if you can see this, I'm not fully closing the throttle this way. I still have a little bit to go, just a couple thousandths. No problem. That's why you have an infinite amount of choices and linkage here. That makes it a lot easier to do that. We've got one working exactly the way we want. I've got full idle. Now the trick is to synchronize so the other one works and they both open exactly the same and shut the same. I put a drop of oil on each one of the linkage parts because I want to have smooth linkage, but I don't want any play in it. Now I thought synchronizing these was going to be a relatively straightforward job. It isn't, and I'll explain what I found is if the servo arms are not synchronized, if one is off even a little bit, the rotation is exponential. So what I started off was getting exactly the same angle. I made a little template up to get on each servo. And then I wanted to start with that point after I re-drilled the holes in the carburetor arms. But this turned out to be the hardest part of the job, and I thought this was going to be kind of easy. But it just shows you. And like anything on a multi-engine plane here, it seems like just nothing can just be zip boom bang. We have not had a zip boom bang in so long. Now, what I've been doing is looking at it this way. Carburetors are both open at the same time. Now, when I start to see the first hint of movement, because what I might want to do is run them at 9. Oh, that's nice. Maybe I should have put the camera on before. Now, until I can get them, the only way I'm going to get them closer is by running the engines once this is ready for its ground running. That worked out well. Time consuming. I'm sure this will need a little fine tuning after we run the engines. I think we're close enough that we can fly the plane. Camera, she at least got a haircut or whatever.
I did get a haircut the other day.
My world famous artist. Now tell him, George, how long did it take you to paint that picture up there? He's an artist. The Conquistador del Galio, whatever it is. Here's what our plan is. George is going to shoot pictures. We set it up for a photo shoot here. George is going to take some pictures. And he's making, you're making an oil painting. Look at this. You want to see disrespect? Look at the bird pooped on my plane.
Already?
Already. Oh, I'm going to kill him. Chicky, you're dead. You're meat. Oh, he poops right on my plane. I don't believe he did this. Oh, you can't scratch it either. I got to soften it with water.
Yeah.
Oh, but anyway, George is going to make an oil painting. He prefers the stance where it's, what's the stance going to be? In a landing mode?
Yeah, it's coming in the landing.
Coming in the landing.
The gear is fixed down. I don't think you'd be fighting a battle with gear down.
Well, sometimes you don't know. And we'll see what he gets in terms of pictures here, so.
Don't look clear, man.
I can give you more light. You want more light?
It's focused. It doesn't.
Now we have two professional photographers. Both of these guys are. I don't know if professional is the right word.
A professional gets paid for what he does.
You that sell one picture for a quarter, you're a professional photographer. I don't know.
I want to get the attitude I got the plane so I can...
Well, that'd be about this shot here, then.
Yeah.
Why don't you stand back here and get...
Well, we did get the servos synchronized today, and that's another step added away.
Yeah, that's just about the angle.
We're closing in on it. We got to make lines up, the handles.
Yeah.
And get our official oil painting done.
I got a double image.
Okay, from Dave Downey in today's mail. Now, I'll tell you, if Ron Merrill isn't interested in building this, I don't know what you would have to do. This looks like one cool project. Now, my only feeling is from looking at it, worrying about these take-apart features and struts, and that kind of makes me crazy so far, but I'm thinking about it every day as a possibility. This is the cool view that I like, too. Like everything Dave does, of course, it's perfect. So, if anybody is psyched for a biplane, and I personally am, I just look at the possibilities of maybe making a bottom wing in one piece. Actually, the possibility of making the two wings in one piece. And somehow getting blocks out here that you could attach them. It's going to take a lot of thought. This is not a simple project, but I'll have all summer to think about it because we won't be starting to build anything till we get back from England. But dreams, as George Venturini, he was just here taking photos. Dreams are free. Job, and we're not going to try to tackle it today because it's going to be a job that I'm sure is going to take some time. These are the original muffler. That Bob made up, and what we did, we changed it the diameter slightly. I'm going to try to get some kind of a rubber, and I don't know how far out this is going to have to go, so this can kind of go back somehow without getting it pinched inside the cowling. He made these oversized so I can just drill them out. Obviously, he's got a nice pressure tap on air if we want to run pressure. Not sure how that's all going to evolve. We're certainly going to look at the possibilities, but this is probably, and I'm looking at my list here, this is probably the last obstacle overcome and making up a set of lines. And today is not going to be a day we make lines. Maybe tomorrow, maybe over the weekend, we'll see. But we have everything that we need right now in-house to put this plane in the air. And the only thing we're really missing is weather. Now today what I wanted to do is a preliminary fit on the mufflers. Bob Zambelli has made up some nice little mufflers and we need to fit where they're going to exit. We need to also fit if we're going to be able to get them to exit kind of in a scale location, not totally scale of course, but we're going to look at those possibilities today. We have plenty of time because it is pouring rain and they don't anticipate any break in the weather for a couple of days. So. With that in mind, now I won't be in any rush at all. Because we're coming down a home stretch on us. I keep saying that, but we really are. And when I finish these mufflers up, I want to bench trim this. I'll be able to. At that point in time, I'll have all the weight, the battery, everything will be in position, and I'll be ready to do a basic bench trimming on a plane and weigh it and see where we stand. Now, the way the Jet 35s are made, this lip, in essence, bolts off, and we don't need it for what the way we're going to mount a muffler. This would be if you wanted to mount the muffler, say, from some other engine or a barrel muffler or something where you wanted to use the two outer holes. Now, we're not going to use the outer holes. We're going to use the inner holes. So we can just unbolt this part, and then we're going to have to see if we have screws. We have some 540 screws long enough for that. That piece off. Now we can get a preliminary fitting on where these mufflers are going to actually exit the cowl. Now, a little problem that I have with the pressure fitting here is, because I don't want to run it out the bottom, originally this was going to go out the bottom, that would be perfect. Well, with the servo here, that makes having it out the bottom a little bit inconvenient. And when I want to run it out the top, I can see I have a clearance problem here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to plug everything up, and I'm going to take a little bit of material off of here just so I can get the pressure fitting. And I need to take probably a 64th of an inch, just a little half moon, a little clearance. Yeah, I didn't take this into account when Bob and I came up with the muffler design. Now, the original one, it was just a little bit different. But this was a little bit different, even the way it was machined, you can see. This one is a little bit nicer, but I still have to remove some of that material. Or I have to resolve that. See, I can't have it under here, because what will happen is, first off, the problem will be that it's going to be too close. It's going to be rubbing on a linkage or the throttle linkage. So the easiest of all things is just going to be to leave a little material off the head here so I can get a nice tight fit up here. Then I put the little gasket in there. Hey! Molting Mario. He's molting all over the place. Now I want to figure out what I want to do with the end of this, how I want to dress it off, or if I want to put one of those rubber extensions on. That's going to just take a little think tank time here. I'll have a cup of coffee while I'm doing it. Estimate exactly where this, by pretty much doing this, by measuring back from the firewall mount, I'm about the thickness of the ruler, and then looking at this from the front view, and estimating where roughly this is going to come out. Now I'm going to just put a very small hole in there so I can kind of get this where I want it to exit the plane. Let's see how close we've gotten on the first try. Again, I don't want this to be a real tight fit. I want to have plenty of clearance for hot air to get out, or else we're going to be burning the paint off of this. I guess the easiest way is to take the needle valve out here for now, because we're going to be putting this on a gazillion times. Then I wanted to try to be able to get these on without taking parts off. That certainly doesn't look like it's going to happen. So that reduces one of the possibilities that we have. If we can do it this way, that means we can't have it that long. That's number one. I'm estimating now I have to take off about 3/8 of an inch of the total length so that I can get the cowling to go over it. So that's the next step, is to cut off roughly 3. I'm just going to guess at that. And I'll take the muffler off the plane to do that. That's the T-wrench. But all these little fits and things like this, you know, and because we're on a rainy day, I'm not under any pressure to kind of hurry it up, because the other thing I have to do is make lines up, and I'd rather not do that on a rainy day, that's for sure, especially solids. Okay, so I'll cut this much off with a hacksaw, dress it off, and then see. I only want to take enough off that I can get that cowling on. See, at that length, are we even close? Okay, now it fits right on. And we need to get clearance on the hole.
Okay, we're hitting on something here.
Okay, I can see the hole has to go further back. So I can take about an eighth of an inch out of the back. The exhaust mounted, you can see that the hole is not really exactly right. Now what I'm going to do is get my hole template and then trace around this so I have an equal amount of air spacing on each side. Now, even though I would have liked this to come out further back, well, you know what? This is about as close to being scale as I think we can get. I don't think we can get a lot better than that. And if what I'm trying to allow for is if it turns out that we get too much oil on a plane, I can wind up putting these little rubber extensions on, which I'd like not to do. I'd like to have it, of course, like that. Hole template, of course. We can... Oh, you always want to have, no matter when you cut a cowling or needle valve hole, you want to get the part to come through. Then once it's through, you can pick the diameter hole, because we have to take into account that this dimension, and we can make the whole hole that dimension. Just an easy way of doing it. And again, I want to have some clearance for hot air coming out of here also. And that looks like we'll about have it right there. Well, that turned out to be about as scale as I think we can make it and still have it practical. We still have the option of putting the rubber, the little elbow on there, which I'm sure somewhere in time we'll just keep some of the oil off the plane. But I think that's about... I had thought about angling this cut back. I could grind that back so it was perfectly flush. I don't know that we want to do that. Molto Mario's checking us out. Hey! Get out of there, Molto Mario. All right, so now the next thing is to just do the second one, make sure everything fits, and then we can get the cowls on and off. And in the worst possible world, what's going to happen is I have to take the needle valves out. But I don't want to shorten this inside, because I don't want to get any extra oil in there that I don't have to. And I think that's going to be about as scale of it, even though it isn't scale. It has the illusion of being scale anyway. After I have both of these done, here's the option I wanted to have is, in case the way these run, they tend to put too much oil on the plane, that I can make some kind of, well, I could make them go back. Got some choices here. Not sure exactly how I'd want to do this. Well, that they don't make ones that look a little more scale. But we do want to have that choice. So we have one more thing done, one more little piece in a puzzle, and I'm guessing the next thing we're going to wind up, we're going to have to wax this. That's another thing. This plane has never been waxed. Before I put fuel in it and test run the motors and do the synchronization in the plane, I would want to give this a really thorough coat of wax. But for right now, we're kind of at the end of this day, and we're going to pull up stakes, come back tomorrow ready to work on this again. Really getting exciting now that we're coming up on the end of this. Hey, George is here with his in the rough pick. Oh my God, that's looking good, George. Hey, I like it. That is great. Now you need another, like, you know what you need here, George? The black, just the silhouette of like four or five other ones getting ready to land in a pattern. Man, that looks good. Well, let's see if you got a likeness here. I don't know. For the price I'm paying, you know, I beggars can't be choosers here. Oh, that looks great. Let's see if we can get them both in the same picture at the same time. Oh, that's going to be nice. Fantastic. Now, this is just a rough out. You'll see when the master here, when Pavarotti gets done singing over here. I'm not sure. Anyway, we'll see this when it's finished. That looks good, George.
Yeah, well, it's...
Yeah. Now, years ago, this is true, whenever I build a new plane, I never bench trimmed it. I went out and flew it first. Big Jim Greenaway introduced me to the idea of bench trimming a model. In other words, before you fly it, see if it falls within the parameters that most models normally trim out at. Now, the first thing I would think everybody, every plane has a set when you build the plans. There's usually a CG location. Now, in most cases, the planes that they've been designed, Cardinals, Impacts, SV-11s, they've already been fine-tuned so that usually the vertical CG will come out close. Now, in our case, because this plane has never been built and we've never been able to establish where that should be or move our components around, we don't know. So this is one thing we're going to have to check for sure. The horizontal CG, any plane that you go to build or fly, it'll list a horizontal CG. In the case of the B-25, because it has a swept forward trailing edge, it needs to be calculated out a little differently than a typical Cardinal or a typical plane with a straight hinge line. So what Dave has done is he's given me a very accurate printout of where 15% of the mean average chord and 20% would be. And what I'm going to try to do is I'd like to balance the plane in this range. I'd like to start, if I had my choice, it would be right here. But if it's a little bit tail heavy here, and I suspect it might be, well, up to 20%, I think it'll be flyable. If it gets much more than 15%, and I almost guarantee that's not going to happen, the plane will probably be too nose heavy to be competitive. But it'll be right in this range right here, where if it falls within this range, then it'll just need to be fine-tuned. And what I'll do is I'll make up some templates so I can mark right on the plane or reference forward where this range will be. It's going to be within this range of 15 to 20% of the mean average chord that we're going to want to start flying the plane with. And having these printouts from Dave is absolutely critical. If you're building a plane that's already been built, use the CG that they show you on the plans. Now, to get an idea of how critical this can be. Now, I know Paul Walker has balanced his planes in the past as far back as 25%, but keep in mind, he's Paul Walker. Most of us aren't. So if you can grab his right arm and his brain and transplant him, well, you probably have a good chance. But we want to establish a point at which this airplane balances, and very accurately. I don't want to just take a stab in the dark. I'd like that to be a very, very accurate measurement. Now, in the past, what I've done, I had a little jig, and it looked like this. It was a piece of 2x4. Unfortunately, it's not in the shop now. I'm going to have to make another one. And it had two pencils in holes or pieces of tubing and a rubber eraser, a pencil eraser up here. And, of course, if you don't have the rubber eraser, you wind up putting two dents in your plane. Well, we may have to fashion up a new one because I want to do this part of it accurately. Now, to give you an idea of why this is critical, or just so you can see it in real life, go down a highway at 55 miles an hour and take a piece of balsa wood, doesn't have to be any bigger than this, and hold it in your hand right up on the front and do a little turn, and you'll see, oh, it's self-stabilizing. As soon as you get it into the airstream, it blows right back to neutral. Well, as you move your balance point back, now it's kind of counterbalanced. Now it gets harder and harder to hold it level. And at some point in time, it's inherently unstable. Well, we've determined after building so many planes over the years that our favorite spot is between, and I believe I'm being accurate here, that Al Raby liked to balance around 15%, so did Bob Barron. My favorite spot is around 20%, but since Dave has them both, it'll just be a question of later in the day or tomorrow, making up a little jig that we can test this on. Okay, so what we're going to do is, if it's, let's say it's nose heavy, which I doubt, we can move the Zetron battery back until we achieve the balance we want. If it's tail heavy, I'll get a bigger and bigger battery, because I have that nose mount. I have a blind nut in here that I can mount the battery to. And so I'll use the battery the same way you would use a nose weight on the crankshaft of a typical plane. I also, to a very small degree, by moving the weight up and down in a plane could alter the vertical CG, but I don't think we're even going to be close on the vertical. We're just going to have to live with what we have and get it fine-tuned with a flap tweak. I don't have any hope that we're going to be right on a vertical CG. And we kind of knew that right from the beginning of building this plane. This is the thing that Rich Jacobone just went into, and he came over here with the plane with almost no tip weight in it, and I said, go home and put 2 ounces of tip weight in it. So that on your initial flights, it's safe. This is a safe setting. Sure, later on you may take some out. You may take, you know, an ounce out. But in the beginning, if the plane is a little bit tweaked one way or another, or the wing is crooked, or some other combination of variables, this is the safe setting. I always like to start with about 2 ounces of tip weight. Well, in the case of a B-25, I've got an ounce already built in that I can't take out, so I'm just going to put the extra ounce. Now, the last thing that'll be significant here is, if you want to be real accurate about this, let me show this on a storyboard. If you want to know how much real tip weight you have, now you could easily put 2 ounces of weight here. And let's just say that your line guide and the fact you didn't hollow this tip out so well was a half an ounce. It would mean you only had an ounce and a half of tip weight. See, the tip weight is actually a balance point. The fulcrum is the center of the body. So the way to do this that I think makes more sense is to just put the spinner on, and in this case you can hold one of the prop blades, hold the tail wheel, and somehow hold the fuselage so it can rotate without any friction, and put a scale under here. And when that wing drops down, if it reads 1 ounce, 2 ounce, that'll give you the true tip weight, not just how much lead is in there. That's a little bit more accurate. And like I said, I would like to start with 2 ounces. Another good starting place is, we have variable lead outs, of course, but we want to find the CG, and maybe another little storyboard here would make this easy to see. If the plane is balancing right here, let's say that's the balance point, we put it up on a little fixture and it balances exactly right there. What I would want to do is trace back to the hinge line, assuming this is a straight hinge line plane. It's not going to work on a B-25. I'm going to have this calculated by Dave because it's a different animal. With the swept forward hinge line, this number is going to change because we don't have a reference point. But what we do have an incline that runs parallel. It runs 90 degrees to the fuselage, so we can maybe reference off of that line. Once I establish this point, I want the lead outs to exit. I want to carry this out to the wingtip and be no further forward than this, and ideally an inch back to start with. 1 inch behind is a very good starting point. Now, a lot of times I've wound up an inch and a half. A lot of times, right up on this spot. Miss Ashley, for instance, balances nose heavy. As a plane gets nose heavy, you move the lead outs further forward. As the plane gets tail heavy, a tail heavy plane needs more and more sweep. The more nose heavy the plane is, the further forward you can put the lead outs. And then, of course, after you fly it, you fine tune them. Possibly the one most people kind of skip or don't want to get involved in is ground running the motors. And after their ground run, if you have filters, clean the filters, tighten all the bolts, what we're going to try to do is run this right in the backyard a couple of times, 3 or 4 times even, because in our case we want to synchronize the carburetors too. And then before we actually take a flight, put a fresh Zetron battery in there, one that's been fully charged, after doing a test run up. But ground running, you know how many people have taken a brand new PA-61, a Tiger 60, a valuable motor, put it in a brand new plane. About halfway through the flight, some garbage comes up from your new tank that hasn't been flushed into the filter. The motor goes dead lean and you fry the motor and take the edge off the performance of the motor for the rest of its effective life. So it assumes you have a motor that's broken in, assumes you have a tank, and in our case, the tanks have been used already. They've been on a test plane. And it assumes that when you're done ground running it, you're going to clean the filters, clean the bolts, tighten the bolts, make sure everything's solid before you put up that first flight. Possibly the biggest single thing that I've changed in the last couple of years, maybe the last 5 years, I never, ever, ever fly a plane that doesn't have taped hinge lines. Two reasons, all these take apart planes, the gap is far enough apart that you absolutely have to seal it. I would say any take apart plane is going to need to be sealed if you're going to put that wire in there. The other thing too, even on planes like the Spitfire, or like planes that have a tight hinge gap, yeah, and think of it this way. Think of when you were a kid, you had a balloon, and the balloon's on a string, and somebody put a pinhole in it. Well, what happened is the difference in air pressure, it just went and it was out of air. Well, with taped hinge lines, the same thing. The air pressure lower on one side than the other. Even a pinhole bleeds some of that valuable lift through. So even though the controls may feel a little strange or you may have trouble the first time you're doing it, I would suggest every plane ever built, unless there's some totally compelling reason, have the hinge lines taped. And we just found that out with Rich's Stuka. It flies 1,000 times better with the hinge lines taped, and he doesn't have a take-apart plane. The key thing, I never wax the plane until I'm ready to put fuel in for the first time. The reason is I want the dope finish to be open to the air and drying out right to the last minute, because it gets hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter. As soon as you wax it, you kind of stagnate that hardening of the finish. Now, in our case, the finish is already buffed out, but what's going to happen? It's going to get hotter and hotter as time goes by, and at the very end, maybe just before one of the big contests, we'll put a real quick polish on it. So the wax is going to impede that. It's not going to let it harden up anymore. As soon as you wax it, you're sealing it to the atmosphere. So I'll wait till the last minute. And by the way, if you're interested, I probably have bought every kind of car wax in the world, automotive wax. The way you tell how good it is how much of the product is carnauba. Now, just as an example, let's go through something here. This is Meguiar's, and I'm looking for, probably this doesn't tell you what the ingredients are, but real good waxes will always tell you how much carnauba is in it. And when you see how much carnauba is in it, this is like a quick wax, so it doesn't have any. All of the waxes that really are worth having, and by the way, you can use molding wax, part oil wax is an excellent, and if a wax goes on and off real easy, it's probably not going to do the job it's supposed to do. In my case, I allowed a better part of a day for waxing the plane and getting in all the corners and edges, because I know fuel is going to get on it, and from priming it and choking it and whatever, I really would like to, if possible, at the last minute before I go outside the bench runner, put that really good coat of wax on it and protect it from any raw fuel it spills or Chicky. We mentioned Chicky's been putting our finishing to the test too. So those are just some of the things that before we actually go any further, I want to get this part of it done and get it pretty much that I'm ready to fly it. I also would like to know, and one other piece of information, kind of postponing doing way in the plane because I needed the mufflers on it, I needed the batteries in it, I needed the Z-tron in it to get a total overall weight. Now what the total weight tells me is, and instead of using a B-25, let's use just a typical Nobler for instance. Let's make up simpler numbers because most people are going to be doing this on a plane that's a little simpler. Some basic thoughts. When a plane is light, when it's really light, that's when it allows you to balance the plane a little further forward than normally would be possible. When a plane gets heavy, it allows you to balance a little bit further back. The reason is when it's heavy, it's making line tension with the weight. What happens here is when it's light and you balance it further back, the plane gets unstable. So there's a lot of complex factors that go into it, but just as an overall general thing, a lightweight model gets balanced nose heavy, a heavy model relatively tail heavy. And I would say the things for me are 15%. If this model came out at 70 ounces, I'd be shooting for 15%. If it comes out at 80 ounces, I'll be shooting for 20%. And anything over 80 ounces, we're really going to be in some unknown shark-infested waters. But that's the challenge. And these are just general things that'll help you get any plane trimmed out, and you want to bench trim it. You want to do all these things, know where you stand, not just take the model after you put the prop and spinner on it and go out and fly it, and it'd be highly disappointed. A good general thing to do is bench trim the plane. Now before I can really do a really accurate balance, I need to take these, and I've done it already, take Dave's drawing, make up my little templates, and mark on the fuselage side. We're going to shoot for maybe 20% and hope that that's where we're going to be. But I want to have the tape on the surface just a little bit further back and a little bit further forward so that I can mark exactly where these percentages are. And again, this will go on the bottom. I just want to show how this will fit on. That's where that'll wind up being. And we're going to shoot for, hopefully, for 20%. Now I marked from the template on both sides where 15 and 20% were, and I want to be in that range. I'm going to go make up another little tool to balance this, but I want to be no further back than this, no further forward than that for my initial flight. Make up another one because I can't remember who even borrowed it, let alone who has it. I always glue it to the table too, just so this thing just doesn't go rocking off. When I'm done, I'll just hit that with the scraper and it'll come. I want to make sure these are solid and that I have, if this is a little soft, I can put a little piece of foam rubber or something up here. That's certainly soft enough. But that becomes my balance beam, and I have those two marks, and I want to figure out exactly where I stand on this. And that is a good handy tool to have no matter what plane you're trimming or balancing or whatever you're doing. An excellent tool. Now I've got it up on a spot here. Whoop. You got to realize that this is something you need to get by a 16th of an inch or so, not just any old spot. Now, let me see if I've got the other side equal. No, I don't. Remember, what we're looking for is the balance, not... Close, close, close. Don't touch it, Wendy. Don't touch it. Ah! Shows you what I'm off. I'm not even is what's happening. Now, depending on how accurate Dave has that little template, and I'm assuming it's very accurate. Whoops. We are on the back half of this. I'm guessing we're... Boy, this is closer than I thought it would be. To be honest with you, whoa. We are, it looks like we're right on the 20% mark. Right there, that's 20%. Now that is, I have to tell you, this is the first time I've ever done this, got the balance on this. So I am impressed. It looks like we're right at 20, maybe 19%. It's just forward of 20%. So all the changes that we made to the plane over the construction, lengthening the nose, had we not done any of them, we'd be adding tons of nose weight now. And believe me, it would take a ton. Now, I don't have the little mount that's going to mount the battery. That's the next thing I'm going to make, is the little Z-tron mount, so that that battery, and that'll just give me a little bit more. It'll probably balance at 18.5%. We know that we're roughly in the league where we want to be. With our little gauge, we can pull this off the table and move on. I've put on, and I've taken the extra stick out of this tape. I've done this before. Mike Rogers actually did this one time with no rubber on the pencil erasers. Put a big dent in the wing. Mike, I still haven't forgiven you for that. Anyway, what I want to do now, convinced that we're just the slightest bit ahead of 20%, maybe 19.5 would be, and that will be fine. That will be fine for a first shot, but if we were at anywhere further back than that, I would be thinking bigger battery for the Z-tron. Now the next part of this is going to be make that little mount for the battery, and then I want to try to get, if I can, get some idea, maybe I'll do it with a storyboard, about how to check to see if your vertical CG is where it should be for an initial first flight. Now what I have is this little battery. I'm just not going to let it just flap around in there. There's a little mount. I'm just going to see if I can make a little piece of plywood with a piece for a zip tie. Should be relatively easy since we know we're close with the battery. We're not way out in left field. Up this little box, it looks like a bathtub for a doll or something. For two little slots for the wire so that this would slide right in and still have some room for a little piece of foam top and bottom while not pinching the wire. And I'm going to make a little lid up for this. A little piece of foam in there, and then I'm just going to mount this into the nose in an appropriate spot. And the reason I wanted to do this is twofold. I wanted to get, we know the vertical CG on this is off, it's very bottom heavy, so this will put the weight further to the top of the plane. And then of course we can either move this, take it out, move the battery back to get a final balance. Maybe we'll want to fly it at 21% balance, 22. Well, we can just take this and move it to the other side, or put it in the tail of the plane and run along a wire extension. So having this little battery box, this is going to be a good little trim feature. I put some lightning holes in the box just in case we need to lighten this area up some. I still have the post if I need to add lead weights. The battery box relatively far forward anyway. I didn't want to get any further than that. It'd be difficult to tighten the screws. The battery drops right in there. The cover goes on top. The connection is made, sure it should be very easy to change that battery when we need to change it. And the way it was lasting on the Typhoon, it was lasting a whole flying day. But if we do go to a bigger battery, we'll just get that box out and make a bigger box. But so far, that was just another one of the details I wanted to take care of today. Now, I wanted to try to check the vertical CG today, and it's just not really practical. Normally, and I'll do a little storyboard, I think it'll be easier to show how to do it on a storyboard. This, when I hang this up from the hook that I have that normally I use to do the vertical CG, it's just so awkward with the bends in the wing and everything, you can't really get an accurate reading. So let me do a little storyboard, just give you an idea how I would do a traditional plane, not this one. If you're doing a plane like this, it's real easy. You can just grab your finger with the outboard wing down. You can put your finger here, right on the center line, right on the center line. And with the outboard tip down, you can get some idea of which side of it is heavy. And you can vary the wheels, of course. Same thing with the Typhoon. You have a lot of choices. But what happens with our plane, with the B-25, it's really just not practical to even hold it that way. There's just so many things in the way. It's awkward. It's probably doable, but it's awkward. So I'm going to try to figure out a little bit better way to do it. Not a measure or to see what we're trying to accomplish with the vertical CG. What we're trying to do is make an imaginary line that goes right through the center of the wing. And have the plane balance on these two points. So one of the things you can do, of course, is you can hang the plane with the outer wing down and just put your fingers there and that'll give you a rough reading. But there's an even more sophisticated way to do this. Now, here's the thing though, once you determine which way it is, very few planes balance right out. The first one you built, the second one you build, of course, you got a better chance. But let's pretend this is the first one and it's top heavy. Now, top heavy being the tail, this part of the engine, and all of this part of the airframe weighs more than the part here that we have in orange. Well, if the top is heavy, here's one of the choices you have. Put on a heavier set of wheels. Another choice is you can add wheel pants. Another choice is you can make the wheels physically longer, just have it end out. Several choices. You can also you can just pretty much figure the rest of this out. Adding anything, a muffler, if you have a Tiger 60 ship, just adding a heavier muffler biases the CG in that direction. Assuming it's not right, and sometimes if it's within range, if it's close, it'll be fine, because then you can take the rest of it out with the flap tweak. But there's a really nice way to do it. If you're willing to spend 45 minutes or a half hour, you can get it exact. Now, the way to do this and find out if you're real close, if you want to get that real final razor edge, is what you do. It's called plumb bobbing, and this can be the roof in your shop, roof in your house, garage, and you put a real decent size hook in there with a bolt on the other end, something nice and solid. Don't do it with a thumbtack or something. Now you hang the plane by the lead outs. Okay, and what you do is you plumb bob it. In other words, you take another hook in front of this. So in other words, this is in the background now, and this plumb bob is on this side. And a plumb bob looks pretty much like this. It's a piece of string. Surveyors use it. And you put a weight on the other end. A prop nut is good, but something heavy. Now what you do is you just manually put your eye over here and look at the plumb bob. And if everything were perfect, the plumb bob would come right in the middle of the wing. Now normally it doesn't. It'll either be out that way a little bit or this way. And you'll see that in the outer tip. So what you do then, you have two choices. You can physically, if you can, move the lead outs up or back so that it's on center. Or you can balance it by adding or subtracting weight from the wheels, usually, or in the other case, top of the plane, maybe this spinner, the nose weight, something. Because you're working with trying to get the vertical CG and the horizontal CG right at the same time. But this plumb bob method, even if it's out by a 16th of an inch and you can't change any more parts, then you wind up with flap tweaks or tabs, because the plane will always tend to fly. If it's heavy on the bottom, it'll tend to fly up like that. If it's heavy on the top, it'll fly like that, tangent to the circle. But if you get it just right, then you really don't, almost every time that you wind up with a real tiny trim tab or a flap tweak, it's the vertical CG you're correcting, not the twist in the wing. So a plumb bob, and just picture putting that right in front and sighting right down real accurately. That's the most accurate way to do it. The problem with our ship is when I try to do this, I wind up with something that looks like this. There's nothing to reference it to. Anyway, I'll think about a better way to do it, but I know right now, I know it's not right on the money. And that's all we're going to get done today. Anyway, tomorrow's another day. We have to weigh the plane. I have to make up lines, wax it, and figure out if it fits in a van. Four things left to do. I think we could do them all tomorrow if the weather's nice. Now today, the moment of truth. We have virtually everything that's going to be on here when we fly the plane and test run it and wax it and whatever. It didn't make sense to really even put it on a scale before then. But it looks like it's an honest 86 ounces. Obviously, that's on the heavy side, but not much we can do about it now. But we do have some choices if somewhere down the line, the weight of the plane becomes an overly dominant issue. We have lighter motors, and we could get as much as, I estimated as much as 5 ounces with lighter motors. We could run it without the Z-tron. We could probably get it down another 2 ounces or 2.5 ounces. And we have lighter props. These are all bolt-on, change-on things. So we probably have a range of the high 70s to mid 80s. And since there's nothing I can do about it, there's no point worrying about it. We're just going to have to go with it. And since it's stopped raining out there, I finally want to get busy and make up the lines because we're coming up on the initial first flight day. So it looks like after all our effort, now just imagine at this point in time, if we had put the extra clear on, well, we'd probably be up to 88 ounces. Not hollowed out, some of the things is hollowed. We'd be over 90 ounces, and obviously that would be way too heavy. As it is, this is probably going to be plenty heavy. We're going to find out. And since it's already too late to do anything about it, hey, we're just going to go with it and see what we have when it comes test flight time at 86 ounces. Before we make up the lines, and today looks like a decent day enough outside that we can make the lines, a lot of people, when I talk to them on the phone, they're confused. They think that what you're measuring is the eyelet to the eyelet. This is not the line length. This is a bogus thing because a lot of times you'll have quite a bit, 2 or 3 feet here and at least a foot here. The proper way, the AMA, the way everybody I know measures lines is from the center of the handle to the center of the fuselage. Now by AMA rules, in our case, that can't be any longer than 70 feet. So if we were to make this 70 feet, we'd be way over length, illegal, probably in some way risk losing the plane. Very important to understand, any measurements we have, we're referring to the center of the handle, to the center of the plane, not eyelet to eyelet. When you order lines, you order 68 foot lines, eyelet to eyelet, you're oversized, illegal, you're risking losing your house, any number of things if there's ever a lawsuit, you are illegal. It's the center of the plane, center of the handle, and what I would suggest anybody could do is out in their driveway or out in their backyard somewhere, put two little sticks in the ground, get a 100-foot ruler, so that you know that's the most it can be. Then measure off 69, 68, down to 60, because it's that last little amount. Every plane that I know that I have in the Air Force is going to be between 60 and 70 feet total length. We just have some typical examples, things that over the years have proven every time to work. A typical Brodack Nobler, or a Greenbox Nobler and a Fox 35. That's kind of a very common combination. The line's 60 foot long, and they can be 015s. Now some of the basic designs that use a 40 or a 46, I'd be thinking 63 feet would be a good length, but remember now, if you're using braided lines, these need to be, anything over a 40 needs to be 018s. And we're not going to even consider four strokes in this. This is just the common two-stroke combinations. Now, I'd say a full-size Super Tiger 60 type of plane, if I were using 018s, and again, that's the rule, I'd be thinking 68 feet. This is just a starting point. Now, there may be some people think, oh, I could fly into here. Yeah, you could fly a 35 ship on 70-foot lines, but it'll never perform exactly the way it should. Now, and these are, again, they're just starting, rough starting points from 3 to basics. And by the way, anything, any profiles smaller that using a Fox 29 or something, or something smaller than a Fox 35, you'd maybe want to go into the 50s, the high 50s, 58 foot. But that's not the majority. These are the three most likely combinations that you'll wind up with. Now, the problem is whenever you use solid lines, I always add 2 feet. So if you're going to If you're going to use solids on this, 62-foot solids, and I do absolutely only 014s. I never even try 012s. I've seen so many people lose planes on 012s. You only get to step on them once. So see how the numbers change if you use solid lines. And this becomes, and this is the case, we're going to make full length. A plane that weighs 86 ounces is not going to fly on short lines. It's going to fly on full length 70-foot 014s. But this just gives you, for the most common combinations, I always, if a plane is trimmed the way I trim it, the braided lines will always wind up roughly 2 feet shorter, and you don't have to trim the plane. You really actually, by using solids, you gain 2 feet of line length, 2 feet of ground clearance, however you want to look at it. But in our case, because we're up 86 ounces, we're not going to do anything except make up a set of 70-foot solids, pull test them with a car on each end, and hope nobody steps on them when we're at the field. Be very, very careful with nobody getting even near them. What I'm going to do is out in the driveway, I already have a marker at 70 feet where I pretty much laid a plane. I take my 100-foot ruler, I verify that I'm not over. And it's always a good idea, make it 2 or 3 inches shorter just in case the lines stretch. Because when you get to the Nats or any big contest, they measure the line. And you don't want to be illegal. There's no gain to it. So I want to have my two markers. I want to wrap the lines. And there's a couple of things about dealing with solid lines. For somebody who may not be familiar with solid lines, these are the do's and don'ts. And I'll do this part of it outside in the driveway today while we have a day it's not raining. First thing with dealing with solid lines is you want to make sure, and in my case, and I would suggest even if you have a trainer plane, never use 012. I have seen so many planes crash with 012s, it's ridiculous. 014 solids. These are, in essence, a little bit stronger than 018 braideds, but they're a little bit more delicate, too. Some of the do's and don'ts. When you buy the wire, make sure you're buying 302 stainless medical-grade wire. When you buy 302 stainless, it says it right on the label, right on the box or bag it comes in. If you buy less expensive wire, and you certainly can, you can buy wire for a very inexpensive price, it's not going to be 302 stainless. Now, the reason you want to have 302 stainless is it doesn't corrode. Now, what happens with less expensive wire, in between flying sessions, the wire builds up a coating on it, and the lines stick, or they grab, or some other bad thing that can happen. 302 stainless is the best material wire. It's very expensive. It's the best. It's the only kind I ever use. And you can identify it just by looking at it. You can see it's much shinier and has a more polished surface than some of the cheaper grades of wire. I know, and I have seen this in real life a lot of times, people trying to wipe lines down with everything from acetone. I've seen Pledge. I've seen Rain-X. I've seen Car Wax. M600, the material that I prefer, isopropyl alcohol. And the only substitute for that is brake parts cleaner. If you use brake parts cleaner and get one drop somewhere on somebody else's plane, you'll be the most unpopular guy. They sell 91% isopropyl alcohol in Rite Aid and CVS. It's marked as 91%. If you can get 91%, that's the best choice. If you can't, 70 is the second choice. But the trick to all solid lines, when people say they're having trouble with solid lines or they're not comfortable or happy, here's what they're doing. They're not wiping them 3 times before a flight. You land the plane, immediately wipe the lines 3 times. You're going to fly again, just before you fly, wipe them 3 times. Now that's 6 wipes. That almost guarantees you're not going to have any problems with lines. It also guarantees another thing. If in between this time and this time, somebody goes out and steps on the wire, you'll feel it in the wire. Rather than losing a plane, or I see a lot of guys never wipe their line. It's not a good idea not to wipe braided lines. All lines should be wiped. But solids have to be wiped all the time, and they have to be maintained. The other thing that's real important, whether you use a Brodak reel or a Windy reel, is a big reel. You never, 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 never put solid lines on one of those little tiny reels where the things come out the side. Right here, here's the reel, and where they come out, with the right here is where they break every time. When somebody loses a plane, that's where they break. It should almost be illegal to put solid wire on a small reel. Big reel. If you're going to do solid lines, when you're going to do solid lines, you're kind of committing yourself to maximum performance. And it's like a guy with a race car saying, I want a race car, I want racing tires. You're committing to the idea that there's going to be some maintenance. They're going to be a lifespan, because solid lines don't last forever. I typically, in the beginning of a season, you notice it's the beginning of the season? When I make these lines up, beginning of the season, find somebody to give last year's lines to, because solid lines seem to have a shelf life of about a year. I don't like using them more than a season. So in the beginning of every season, and certainly in the beginning of every new plane, make a new set. Also, another thing that I do, I make a dedicated for each plane. A reel, and this reel will have the B25 thing, a dedicated handle. And I always put that orange tubing over the line connectors. Now, once I make this over here, reel, the lines, the handle, that stays with that plane forever. Once I get the handle cable fine-tuned, I'll wrap the handle with grip tape. That stays with that plane forever. I don't go out to the field, oh, let's hook it up for the ringmaster, or let's hook it up for the combat. One plane, one reel, one handle for the life of the plane. And that, using these tips, everybody should be able to use solid lines and take advantage of the performance gain without ever having more trouble than you'd have with any other lines. I think this is just good common sense information. Now, this is the way medical grade wire is sold. It's sold in 500 foot rolls. It's not on a reel. You have to put it on its own reel. It's sometimes tricky to do that. You want to hold it like this and just let it uncoil out. It's easier to do it with a helper. I'll do that one of these days when we're at the club field and I have a helper. I don't have a helper today, so I can't do that. What I like to do is put it on a reel. You can notice how shiny this is relative to non-surgical wire. This is a whole different animal. It has a much smoother, you can even feel the difference. So now you have a couple of things that I like to do is I mark the reel with the date. It's 2002, because I have in my spare supply, I have maybe 20 of these, and I never use them up. But the wire that's left over, you could make stooge lines out of it. We have these people in the club that I know are financially handicapped. They don't have steady jobs or kids in college, so they can basically have that, the leftover wire. I want the prime cut of beef here, though. I want brand new wire in 2002. Now what I'll do, I'll show how I wrap one end of this, and then I'll go outside to the driveway, do the cut lengths, and put the equivalent of getting a set of lines made. And what I do, as long as I'm going to do this, I have, notice it's 2002, I don't have lines on it yet, full length lines for Miss Ashley. So I make a separate dedicated reel with the date on it, and I know then a couple of years from now, assuming the plane lasts that long, I know what year I made the lines, and I don't want them to be more than 1 year old. So this will be my reel for a set of full-length solids for Miss Ashley, and because we're going to be coming up on the flying season, this is a good day. If you're going to make lines, set up the ruler in a driveway, make up lines. I got a reel for the B25, very clearly showing the date, and I have 500 feet of wire to make it up. Now, let me just show how I wrap one end of this. A lot of people think you wrap the end of a solid line a whole lot different. It's really no different at all. I'll do one on camera, and then we'll get outside and cut wire. Remember, and by the way, whenever I do this, this is the time, because you're going to have a new lines, you're going to have a new handle setting, this is the time you want to replace the handle cable. Every year, replace the handle cables. Every year, make a new set of solids. You got, it's, now you're never going to get a flat tire. You know, it's like you don't wear tires down until they're bald. You get rid of them before they break. Well, same thing with lines. They have a shelf life. You've got to kind of commit to the idea of, and handle cables. All these things have a shelf life. Now, when you're doing solid lines, especially, I like to use the bigger of these eyelets come in two sizes. They come in a smaller size and a larger size. I don't know what the diameter is, but what I did years ago is, because I was using so many of them, and I use them on my belt cranks, I bought a whole jar of them when they were available this way. Now, John Brodak sells line eyelet ends, but if you have a choice, specify the bigger of the two sizes. They're better for wrapping solid lines. So we want to have one of these that's larger size. Now, John Brodak sells wrapping wire. I just happen to have these. This comes from Radio Shack. It comes in three different colors because I like to mark the upline with some kind of an identifying little marker when I'm done with it. It's about it's soft copper wire. I need a piece about 2.5 feet long to wrap an end. So now what I have is a piece of soft copper wire, a large eyelet, and I'm ready to wrap. Now what I do, I just put a little bit of tissue up under here because I don't want this, believe me, the minute you let the solid lines go, they open up like a slinky. So I want to hold that in position. I want to give myself a couple feet of wire. I'll try to do this as close to the camera lens as I possibly can, but keep in mind when I look through the camera lens, it's a little bit different. And it's best before you even wrap a set of solid lines. See, there's trick number one. You don't want to kink it right now. You want to leave maybe 9 inches, 8-9 inches of wire out there. Get the wrap as tight as possible. By the way, now, Warren Tiart makes this great little gizmo. We texted it at the Nats. I don't have one, but certainly when Kent Tyser had one, it looked like it worked perfectly. And if you're going to do a lot of line wrapping, that, if you have an Air Force with 6, 8, 10 planes, that may be a good investment. Now, at some point in time, I've got just a little bit wrapped here. This is probably a total of an inch. I can get the back of it tightened up. And now before I go any further, I bend this up 90 degrees. And what that does, that now it doesn't let this slide back down. Now usually when you wrap 3 or 4 sets of lines, your fingertips feel like raw meat. Now I'm right about at the diameter that I can insert my large eyelet. And it'll stay there. That's the point at which you want it to stay there. You do not want to kink that end piece. Another thing, you never want to put any glue, any solder, any epoxy, anything on the end of the wire. Because the beauty of a soft wrap, this is called a soft wrap, is it's a little bit of a shock absorbing system. And when you put glue on there, you eliminate the shock absorbing and you make it brittle. And brittle breaks, and shock absorbing doesn't. Now with an 86 ounce plane, these lines are going to get put to the test. Now see, I've guessed lucky because I'd really, when I want to end it, I want to have about that much left over. Now I want to bend this piece completely back over. Trim it off right even with the eyelet for now. And now this is the tricky part. Not real tricky, but I need to go one wrap at a time, make them as tight because my eyes are not good. This gives my eyes a good workout. But I try to put all the do's and don'ts on because the great majority of people that use solid lines for competition or even for sport flying, the performance gain is very large. But you have to deal with the maintenance and with the fact that they have a shelf life and the walking back and forth, which in my case is, I look at it as good exercise because I'm always looking for some way to get more exercise. I want to get this one. I'm trying to wrap it nice and neat and tight. Every once in a while, just let the wire untwist, because you're putting a torque twist in the wire as you're doing this. But you'll notice too, whenever you make a brand new set of solids and you take the old set of solids off, the plane has a much more velvety, smooth feel, because the wires actually wear out from rubbing on each other. They get rough. They lose some of their polish. Okay, now we get to the end. And by the way, Tom Morris wraps wires for you, wraps lines. You don't want to do this, it's real easy, but I would, if you have Tom do it, I'd have him put them right on a big reel and make sure he's using 302 stainless, that's all. Now I take that little piece and just put it up in there. Then I hope that information serves you well. Now the rest of it is pretty self-explanatory. I'll put a nail in the ground here, put one end on, go wrap the other end at 70 feet, and make another end, put it on a nail. So when I get to the end, the both of them will be exactly equal. And what that allows me to do is switch from, without having to make major adjustments in the handle, if I wanted to go, say in the case of the B25, I may want to have a spare set of lines and a spare handle. But I don't want to have one where one set of lines is like this, one is like this, one is equal. Make them all equal. That's a good starting place to put them. And I hope you'll have real good luck with your solid lines. You'll find if you can tolerate the extra walking and the extra wiping, you'll love the performance advantage. And you can also fly the plane with a little bit less tip weight. In our case, we got so much tip weight in there, it almost wouldn't sit on a scale, but I just want to be safe. I always mark both ends of the up line, in my case, with a little piece of wire, because I want to know when I set these up, I want to have kind of a safety thing. So the up line will always be the up line on all of the planes in my collection here. I always use these. This is fishing tubing, by the way. Any place that sells fishing supplies has it. It's very soft. The other reason for this is it's visible. It's very visible. Now what I did, I made this handle up with a little reinforcement piece here just to give me a bigger grip, because I know this plane will have a little bit of line tension. So just to cover myself, having a wider grip will just be easier on my hand after a day of test flying. Now the objective of the soft tubing is to cover the clip so you don't have the clip twist up on you. You can see how nice that is. When that's all done, there's no way that can twist up or be a problem. Safety strap. These came from Roger Ladd's. I really like these. You can get these right from Roger Ladd's. That hooks on nice. I got a little thumb rest because this plane I'm anticipating doing a lot of that. And we'll find out. Anyway, that completes one more little piece of the things that we're going to need to get a test flight in on a plane. And every time we get one more step further into it, the anticipation gets higher and higher. Now the next thing I want to do is I want to really get the plane covered with wax, because we're going to do the test run up on it. Part of the day, I guess a part of the day, part of the project that I look forward to, well, because remember, I used to have a custom motorcycle painting business of my own. And the guys that, I can't even get this hand open. The guys that really were into this custom car thing, in fact, I may as well have to use, I probably have to use this. One of the things they always would do is with lacquer finishes, any kind of lacquer finish, you always were tempted to, as soon as you were done, put wax on it. And boy, that would just not a good thing to do. Now I have this can from years ago. I think Jeff Stifel gave me this. But look at the can, and let's see how old it is. Somewhere on here it says, okay, let me get this on here. Pure Carnauba. Now, Pure Carnauba, I'm not sure where you buy this, but a can like this is usually about $30. This is the real McCoy. If you're going to go to any length to have a nice finish,
right now, we've really put hundreds of hours, literally hundreds of hours, into this project. And right now, we're getting ready to put fuel in the plane for its first run-up. Well, if you don't have wax, and I don't mean this wax that you spray on like Pledge and wipe it off. Yeah, that doesn't leave any protection. What I'm looking for here is protection, not the shine. I want the protection. Nothing, I've never found anything better than this. The only thing that even comes close is the part all wax, high temperature wax that they sell for mold release. Now, remember, it's protection. And I know a lot of people, and not even going to mention any names here. They're done with their dope finish. They buff it out. Next day, they wax it. Now they get to the field. Raw fuel drips down it. You've got a problem. You can deteriorate the finish. This is good protection. Relatively easy to do, but you gotta realize this is not like rub it on, rub it off. This is a real wax, like in the old days when you paid somebody to Simonize your car and it took them all day to do it. Yeah, this is the real thing. First thing, you never want to do this in bright sun. Don't even think about putting this kind of wax on in the bright sun. You want to put it on. You want to put it on with a soft sponge applicator. Something, get a nice coat of it on, let it get almost dry, and then we need some soft towels or some soft terry cloth, cheesecloth, something to wipe it off. But when we're done, we'll have some real protection on this. Now I'm real careful with this, and I'm allowing the better part of a day to wax this plane. This is like the old days with Simonize, not that quick one-shot thing. This stuff really works. I want to get it on. I have those little chocks under the wheels of the plane. I want to rub it on. There's no cleaner whatsoever in this wax. There's no grit, there's no grime. You can put it on, do a spot about this big. Now you got to give this 5 or 10 minutes to dry, a couple of minutes anyway. Shop conditions are cold here, so if it were in California, it might go a little quicker, but I want to make sure every part of this plane before I put fuel in it. I mean, keep in mind, how many hours do we have invested in this? Now let me just let that dry for a few minutes and we'll get ready. Polish it up. This is just one of the jet rags. It's terry cloth. You want some nice soft terry cloth, something without some globs of CA on it. Or Bounty paper towels, I guess. But I wanted to do this one little spot because I want to show a little demonstration. Okay, that's about all it's going to take. But once we get up around the nacelles and the motor, this is going to be time consuming. You rub that with your hand. You can absolutely feel a difference. I could tell exactly where the wax stopped. It's like, you hit the brakes. That is really... And if you buy a can of wax, you know, the funny thing, you buy a can of wax with $3 in ShopRite, it isn't going to be pure carnauba. Just take a little bit of water. See how the water beads up when it's waxed? So you know you're getting at least in my case, you're getting some protection here. Again, I'll do this off camera. I'm going to take the whole model I want at the end of this day before I put any, may not even get the fuel, I don't get to run it up today, but to have that coat of protection after all this time we've spent, worth every minute I'll spend doing it.
Some great pictures of the side cannons.
Now Les came over. Les's job today, he's going to do it on camera too. He doesn't know it. We just commissioned him to make the cannons for the plane.
But I get nervous on camera.
Now say, tell everybody, you're a real gun maven. I mean, you're the gun champion of the world or something. Shotgun champion.
Not the world. I'm a skate shooter.
Skate shooter, okay. So he comes over and he says, oh, don't worry, Wendy. I have the afternoon off. I'll make you up all the cool cannons for the plane. No problem. And in fact, we're already looking at the stuff. Though remember, they can't stay on a plane when it's flying. That's out of the question. The thing's going to be like a coat hanger. So if you make a little fixture that you can drill those holes, I have black aluminum tubing anodized. And let's hope Saturday the weather's good for a test flight. You going to be there for the test flight or
am I?
You going away?
No, I'm here.
You're here, okay.
I'm here.
If you weren't, Chicky's molting. Les's best friend.
Oh, good.
Chicken, he's going to be here Saturday for the test flight. Yeah, figure out how we can make a little trough.
In other words, the holes are all in one straight line.
Right, right. And all you have to do is be able to keep it uniform, then rotate it uniformly.
Exactly, exactly. So you just can't do it randomly. But I got some carbon fiber tubes, too. So let me get out. Let's see what kind of brainchild you have here. We're dependent on you for this. Or else I'll let you take the tubing home, and while I'm on vacation, you can do it. But what do you think? Does it look like a B-20? The truth. Does it have the B-25 look?
It certainly does.
Oh, that's your ink work, Les, that made it
now,
that way.
I have never seen, Wendy, very honestly, that B-17. But I got to tell you, this is as much a B-25 as that B-17 is a B-17.
Yeah, well, there's a point of no return. Obviously, you can't make it perfectly scale, but I think we're close.
Yep. Beautiful, beautiful airplane.
Cannons. We need cannons, baby.
Cannons.
Are coming. He's there in full. What is he doing? He's got a. Get out of your kid. Oh, he's eating something. He's eating a PVA. Get out of there. Give me that. Hey, he's got the PVA. Guy, you can't eat the PVA, you dope bird.
He'll find him.
Okay, he's making up a little jig. Now the way Les figured this out was very cute. The length of the nose cannon is the diameter of the nose wheel. So we know that's 2 inches. So he's making up a little jig so that we have the right amount of holes in the cannon. And that they're equally spaced, you can see how they are in the tail cannon at least. I wonder if they're all the same cannons.
If they aren't, they're going to be.
Oh,
if
man.
If they aren't, they're going to be.
I hope they're more than 22s. Yeah, you're right. No, these are just going to be for like when you take a photo shoot. I'm not going to be flying with these on. It'd be neat to have them. We came up with the little detail it holds it on. We even have one. An eyelet is just exactly the right diameter. And we have the cannon. He's been practicing drilling holes, and I have anodized tubing. So we'll see what. He's the master of detail, the master of distress. Masters of the universe.
Master of distress is right.
Oh, man. Okay, let's see how that works.
All right, now, you know, I'll tell you something. Rather than glue this, well...
You can hold it. You can make two, let me figure this out.
No, holding it doesn't give you enough leverage. The drill wants to walk. So, we're...
First okay, hole, so put give a us key some... pin down in this block that's basically just acting like a V-block.
Yep, that's all.
Quiet, Chicky. Gotta drill a hole in your beak.
10, 12, 14, 16. Oh, where's...
Chicky!
And this will be the last one.
You're molting, you're ugly.
All right. Let's see what we got.
Is that the smallest drill we have, Les?
No. The smallest one is very
small. I have jet drills. I have jet drills back there if you want.
No, George Gatos Jr.
Oh, George Gatos would know how to make these cannons. Okay, now we got a slider block so that all the holes in the cannon are going to line up. But the thing is, once you get into scale modeling, like, you know, and you want to do something, this is nice, like you can make other parts. Now you can slide that back, that part will just slide up against that rail.
Give us nice uniform distance.
Off the floor! Hey! Get off that floor. Watch when you back up, he's on the floor.
Okay. All right, okay. Let's try a few.
Try a couple, let's see what,
see
we,
what we get here. See, wants the walk.
Now, the way you get around that, shorten the drill.
Yep.
Master machinist Wendy Ertnowski. It only took me a year to figure that out. Yeah, shorten the drill so you just have eighth of an inch showing. You know what I used to hate? My business partner, Joe Cassie. He'd look at a job like this and he'd always have some tricky little way. But first he'd let you do it the hard way so that you had some respect for him when you were done. He'd let you drill 30 holes by hand and then tell you how to make a jig or something. Or tell you to shorten the drill. Okay, there you go. I'll bet that'll work. I think even using that Dremel bit, the Dremel bit will work good in there.
Well, our spacing here we go.
It's the spacing that's a problem?
No, not yet.
It's not drinking water yet, bird. Never save a baby bird from destruction. You'll be saddled for life with a chickadoolie. Yeah, George Gatiss really had some of these things figured out. Little, that P-38, the little hydraulic lines that went down to the landing gear and everything. Oh, man.
Still wants to walk. You believe that?
You could shorten it even more, I'll bet. Try using that Dremel bit. Oh, it looks like you got it. What are you talking about?
Yeah, well, it's...
Yeah, I think you got it.
Just a little off center.
We got it. We got to have these working because George already has them painted into the picture with screwed if we don't finish them. Now what Les is trying to work on is the orientation. As some of the holes go 9 and 3 and some are 12 and 6. So he's put a pin in. This is where it pays to have a master, the master of guns.
Right.
What shall we nickname you, Gunmaster? Chicky agreed, if you do a nice job on these guns, he's not going to poop on you all
good
day.
Oh, that's...
Pooped on a B-25 when we were taking pictures of it.
Did he really?
Oh! Oh, no respect.
I'm damn ingrate.
Bad enough the judges don't give you any respect when your own bird doesn't. Get off of my drawings. Send you to go live with somebody else and you'll see how mean they can be. Got the final product to be coming out.
Oh, this is it. If this works.
Oh, we're in the cannon business.
Right.
We can advertise these in Stunt News. Free cannons for your next stunter.
Yeah, but at the rate I'm producing, they'd be $400 a piece.
Or more. And once we clean the edges, we got to figure which tool to deburr them. Oh, that's nice. I'm telling you, baby.
That'll work. That will work, sir.
Even Chicky likes that. Celeste is a real gunner. And he really is a gunner, by the way. He knows that the real gun has a muzzle like this, and it would have a barrel inside the... What is this, the shield? What do they call this part of the gun?
Well, basically what it is a... it supports the barrel and provides additional cooling.
Okay. So now we have a gun barrel inside this sheath. And we're going to center it with another piece of aluminum tubing up at this end. But now you can look in and actually, through the cooling hole, see the barrel of the gun. And that is a nice final touch. This Les is an okay guy. And here's the final assembled gun. 3 pieces of tubing. Totally out of control. Now I just need to trim this off and figure some non-permanent way of mounting this, because we are not going flying with the guns blazing. Les, you sure you can't make these guns work? You know, some guy gives you a bad takeoff score.
Listen, I can make them work. You're going to have to make the bullets.
I'm not sure Chicky approves. What do you think of that gun?
What'd he say?
He likes it. He's impressed. Les, you've outdone yourself. It actually shows the real barrel going right through in the jacket, just the way the real one would be. Wow. Well, we got to make up some tail guns here. And I think there is a point in which, in the building of any model, where you decide you're going to go for it, or you're just going to cut bait. What did I say? You're going to fish or cut bait. Well,
those look
taking real. Full credit for his offer.
Not me. Those look real. How'd that happen?
Well, you got the barrel right in the sleeve, just the way the real one is. That's pretty cool.
Not bad. It worked out well. Worked out.
Absolutely beautiful. You're okay. I don't care what Rich Jacobone says about you.
Oh, has he been talking about me again?
Yeah. Well, thanks to Les Stemmett's help, we now have one more detail. We have another day of Les had a couple of ideas for making the waste gunner station cannons and the turret can. We didn't get a chance to do them today, but we're at the end of this tape, and it should be within the next couple days if the weather breaks. We got another rainy day out there today. We're ready to fly. It's the only things holding us up right now is the weather. I hope you enjoyed the tape, and I hope we will see you on the next tape. And I hope within the time of the next tape, obviously, the objective is to get this flown. But we're sure not going to take a chance flying it without having some really decent weather. Anyway, again, please share the tapes with all the guys that enjoy this hobby, this event. Modeling itself, I really think, is just the most fun you can have, the safest, most productive thing you can do with a 56-year-old life. And the quality and class of the people that you get to meet along the way is just unbelievably good.